for something we use for all sorts of things here on Earth, in astrophysics, the element lithium has in the past seemed somewhat uninteresting, a minor product of the Big Bang. But the chemists might disagree here, because lithium is really interesting and reactive. The least heavy solid element, and metal, lithium is highly reactive in Earth's atmosphere, and like all alkali metals, is flammable here. If you want to keep it safe, you need to put it under mineral oil, or some other inert medium or vacuum. Even if it doesn't catch fire, it very quickly corrodes in air, first going dull gray from bright metallic, then to black. And it's so soft it can be cut with a knife. But you need to treat it with much care. It can simply combust. And if you get it near water, it explodes. Lithium is industrially very useful. Two obvious uses are for lithium-ion batteries and in medicine. Though in medicine in the past, it was not always used to good effect. It actually became a widespread cure-all, popular in the late 19th and early 20th centuries, to the point that people would seek out lithiated springs to take the waters, in hopes of gaining benefit. And lithiated water became popular to drink, and even the beverage 7-Up got its start as a lithiated beverage until it was removed in the 40s. And there still are natural, spring, lithium-containing water sold, though it's not much of a marketing point these days. But its salts did have a legitimate medical use, after all, in psychiatry, a use it still has and is well proven. But there's more to lithium. Yes, if you're using a rechargeable lithium-ion battery, say a phone, some of that lithium is from the Big Bang itself. Those batteries are everywhere, but there is more. Lithium grease is another use as a very good lubricant. Lithium is used in the manufacturing of ceramics and glass, nano-welding and fireworks, torpedo engines and fuel, and strangely it even has a use in specialized optics as artificially grown crystals of lithium fluoride. As a lens component, it has really low refractivity, making it useful for infrared and UV light, and on and on. And then there's nuclear hydrogen bomb detonations. Here is one of the strangest stories of the nuclear age, where scientists building a hydrogen bomb got it very wrong. This test, known as Castle Bravo, held at Bikini Atoll, constitutes the largest nuclear detonation the United States ever produced, though it was nowhere near as big as the Soviet Tsar Bomba test. That blast, Tsar Bomba, which was intentionally that large, probably will keep the record permanently, as nuclear weapons development moved away from singular large megabombs. Lithium was very important to the design of the Castle Bravo device, however. The problem is that the most abundant form of lithium by far is lithium 7. What that detonation required was lithium 6, however, well, so they thought. And at the time, it was very expensive to separate out all of the lithium 7 from the 6. The scientists involved thought that the lithium 7, much of which was forged in the Big Bang, would be inert and not take part in the reaction, and they could get by with a large presence of it. And they were wrong, it did participate, and it resulted in a 15 megaton detonation instead of the intended 5, and spread dangerous fallout widely, including over actively operating fishing boats and inhabited islands. The Big Bang did not entirely approve of the Little Bang, it seems, and reminded us that we don't always know what we think we know. But that was dwarfed, however, by the intentional 50 megatons of Tsar Bomba, which actually had a capacity to go up to 100 megatons, but the Soviets felt that that level was too dangerous to test. That aspect of lithium aside, lithium was also one of the first elements forged in the Big Bang itself, but in very, very low quantity compared to hydrogen and helium. Beryllium in very minor amounts also appears. This has led many astronomers disregarding lithium and thinking about the Big Bang and its aftermath, because there was so little of it synthesized by the Big Bang, to the point that you can term it a trace amount compared to hydrogen and helium. Lithium is also still being created in the universe. In addition to the Big Bang, the element can be created by cosmic rays smashing into atomic nuclei in space, and inside stars under very specific conditions. This actually didn't add up until recently for lithium that was created after the Big Bang. There it had the opposite problem of there being too much lithium now, situationally, as opposed to too little primordial lithium. Turns out, the answer was in classical stellar novae, where observations of lithium were made in the afterglow of one of the events. The nova in question, known as Nova Centauri, occurred in 2013 and was actually quite bright, reaching a magnitude of 3.3, which is astronomically very bright when seen from Earth. The nova was observed emitting gamma rays and X-rays. In 2015, lithium was observed in the materials ejected from the nova event, the first time this has been seen, superficially seemingly solving the question, and answering yet another question about population 1 stars having extra lithium. There was more being produced than had been known, but there was an issue, more on that in a bit. But there are actually a number of other mysteries and problems involving lithium, and the first starts with the Big Bang itself, and what is known as the cosmological lithium problem. It comes down to this. Lithium was actually a bit difficult for the Big Bang to make because of the mechanism, but not that hard. The problem is that most models of the Big Bang predict significantly higher amounts of primordial lithium than what there appears to have been, up to 3 times what we see evidence for now, especially in meteorites, should have been formed and should be more evident in metal-poor population 2 stars. Why that is not known, but it really just falls down to one thing, and we don't really understand what it is. The models do predict hydrogen and helium abundances correctly, so that means there's either something wrong with the model, making it predict only partially correctly, or the prediction is accurate and the measurements of primordial lithium in the universe are wrong, which is not actually all that unlikely, or both could be wrong. Or something weird could be going on with stars themselves that is destroying lithium in their cores in some way that we aren't aware of. There can still be very surprising things in stellar physics, and that's one area we don't completely have a handle on. Or something is destroying lithium in the universe overall, and we have no idea what it is. The problem is, these types of scenarios with stars wouldn't seem like enough to account for the huge discrepancy in the problem. Remember, we're talking 3 or 4 times more lithium predicted than what was actually present. The discrepancy is large. It does, however, pay here to point out something about lithium as an element. It's actually a rather fragile atom, 3 protons in the nucleus and a loosely held outer electron, easy to ionize, which makes it hard to see astronomically, and also easy to destroy in the core of a star, which is conspicuous. This stuff can be destroyed easier than a lot of other common atoms. It's also a big problem for the nova explanation. Lithium should get torn apart into hydrogen and helium there. So whatever is responsible for all of this, it ultimately still remains unknown. But there is another option where they might both be right and something else is at play. And here's where it gets even weirder. We know there's new physics yet to be discovered. And then there is the wide open question of dark matter. You can't invoke it here, we don't know enough for that. But you could leave a door open for dark matter to have had an influence on the formation of elements in the evolution of the universe. Or alternatively, we can't actually tell if the laws of physics have remained completely constant over time. Cosmic inflation suggests otherwise, so that might also have had some kind of an effect causing lesser lithium to have been synthesized. So for now, this mystery remains open. And there's plenty more strangeness. One study of 500 stars showed that for some reason, sun-like stars that do not have planets, so far as we can tell, have on the order of 10 times more lithium than sun-like stars that do have planets, including our solar system. This skews towards younger stars for some reason. It's still open as to why this is, but one hypothesis stands out, though it is extremely contentious. That formed planets influencing their star with their gravity may be churning up lithium, which is then convected deep into the star where it can be burned in the core, seemingly depleting it. Without planets, this does not happen. This has an interesting effect if that's the case. Then it gives us a rather robust tool in identifying new exoplanets. Right now, we only have a handful of methods, and they all depend on some sort of lucky alignment to see them, such as a transit. But here, if this can be established, we would be able to look for planets we wouldn't normally see or even discover with the other methods, just by following the lithium levels in the parent star. The next oddity here is that there are also higher levels of lithium where you would not expect to find them in certain orange stars that orbit neutron stars and black holes. But this one has a somewhat obvious solution in that gravity sources that great could easily be expected to draw up lithium to visibility in the atmosphere of those stars. So they don't actually have abnormal amounts of lithium, they just show more of it because it's getting drawn upward, which may help to lend some credence to the idea of planets also doing this. But there it seems to be more complicated because planets orbiting are going to vary in mass and configuration, and it's less clean cut. Ultimately though, the story of lithium in the universe may just come down to its fragileness and the apparently very complicated story involving it. We may just not yet understand enough about what happens to lithium and how it is formed and survives, and therein are the answers. We just haven't studied it enough and thought about it enough to have a satisfying model of the story of lithium. All we know is that it was more important of an element in cosmology than we knew before, and presents unique mysteries in understanding the cosmos. But it also remains an issue here on Earth in that, like many rare elements, we only have a finite supply, and we are still very heavily dependent on it for things like our batteries, though there are alternatives. At the same time, recycling lithium-ion batteries is something we already do, but expanding the mining supply is problematic as demand grows, as are lithium levels in the water supply coming from our civilization. There is such a thing as too much in the water. So lithium, for all its unforeseen mysteries in nature, is something that in our modern world we deal with every day, and that is not likely to change. Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently addressing those accusing me of an anti-elemental boron bias since my last outro. I was joking, so next up in the Mysteries of the Elements videos is beryllium, which has some very intriguing properties. And then comes boron. And yeah, it has a certain connection in its chemistry to the possibilities of alien life, coming up relatively soon. And be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.